Afghanistan. We've been watching this debacle unfold. Some people call it a catastrophe. Some people call it inevitable that this was going to happen no matter what administration was in charge, no matter how the United States ever sought to eject itself from this mess in the Middle East. Or some people are asking on the flip side of that, well, why did we leave in the first place? You know, maybe this was something that we should have had a stronger presence there. And so as we have been watching in almost horror and disgust the rapid pace at which the entire situation just crumbled before our very eyes. If you recall that in the lead up to this, we've talked about it here on the show. We're not going to do a postmortem on all of that. But Joe Biden, Anthony Blinken, they were saying for a long time, in conjunction with all of our military intelligence, all of the generals, we're all over the media. This is not going to be a problem. We've got it figured out. We've got contingencies planned every which way. Then, as the withdrawal starts, we see a different story. We see this cascade of panic from our own embassy, from our own adults in the room who are now supposed to be in charge of this stuff. We're seeing scrambling troops were pulled out and then sent back in. And everybody, including people in the mainstream media, people who generally would be very favorable to the Biden administration, are left scratching their heads saying, what the heck just happened? I thought we elected the adults, the sophisticated people. I thought this was the administration that was supposed to regain America's standing in the world because that orange Cheeto was so destructive to the country's standing on the global stage that only Joe Biden, only a man who could be in government for the last 40 years, only could he restore the beauty of America standing throughout the globe. And now it's not happening. Now we're seeing a very long list of people who are upset with what the United States has gotten themselves into and how they are leaving on the way out. So we're going to spend some time taking a quick look at what the other media had to say. Here is what the New York Times was chiming in about. Says that the Taliban capture Kabul, stunning U.S. as a 20-year effort unravels in days. They're even surprised about it. They say panic spreads as thousands try to escape. They say after a week under new rulers, Kunduz may be a hint of future. I think that's talking about Afghanistan. We have here for Biden, these are images that he wanted to avoid, right? So a whole front page, everything above the fold, Monday, August 16th, for posterity, we'll go through it from the New York Times. Not a good headline, not a good day there for Joe Biden and the Biden administration. Over here with the Washington Post, big headline from them, Afghanistan falls to the Taliban, the same Taliban that many people were saying for a long time had already been defeated. George Bush said that they were on their way out long, long time ago, and it's been sort of the same story indefinitely. Washington Post is acknowledging it, saying that militants face little resistance as they overtake Kabul, concluding a surge that far outpaced U.S. estimates. Begging the question, why is this something that the administration was not prepared for? The Pentagon rushes additional troops to capital aid in chaotic effort to evacuate the personnel. They say desertions and illegal deals accelerated the military collapse. So if Afghanistan collapsed and there were desertions and illegal deals, are we ever going to get to the bottom of that? It says, afraid for lives, activists plead for help. Biden takes a cold-eyed view of the debacle, which is a little bit unusual for Joe. He's old Grandpa Joe, very friendly. You know him, Joe? Yeah, we're just, you know, just go-lucky, happy-go-lucky Joe. And now Joe's pretty stern. People are wondering what that looks like, what that about face was all about. President flees. Thousands clamor to board the flights. We're going to take a look at some of what happened there. Over at the Wall Street Journal, we have Taliban seizes power as the U.S. retreats. You see them rolling into Kabul just in a victory, taking control of the entire city. Fighters take control of the capital as the president flees and concedes defeat. Biden stands by troop withdrawal despite the criticism. There's a desperate rush to get out. They're saying that this was Saigon on steroids here at the Wall Street Journal. This was a quote from another person who was nearby. So this is not a good day for the Biden administration. And any of these Saigon comparisons, you may have seen them. We saw this picture over at the USA Today, this Chinook helicopter flying over an American embassy in Kabul. This was the exact scene that Joe Biden said that he did not want to see. In fact, when people were asking him about this, saying there's absolutely no way that this is going to happen. Specifically, there's no way that we're going to have a helicopter that is taking people out of American embassies like we had in Saigon. And I know there's some little detail facts. Well, is it really the embassy and all of that? But the point here, it is kind of the same thing, right? This was a catastrophic collapse happened from like a Friday to a Sunday Within a couple days, the entire city had been seized. And this was exactly what they said would not happen. Joe Biden was asked about this, said, you know, is it possible that this could look like Vietnam, or could this be anything like that? And they said, and he said specifically, no, absolutely not. Well, why not? Because they have 300,000 well-armed troops. They've got an air force. They've got a lot of the infrastructure that any modern military would have. And so necessarily they'll be able to rebut any attack from the Taliban. Well, that's not what happened at all. We see here at USA Today, actual photographs of a Chinook helicopter coming in and pulling people out of the embassy in exactly the fashion that Joe Biden said it would not happen. So Afghanistan falls, Taliban seizes the capital, government collapse, U.S. scrambles to evacuate as panic grips the Afghans. We have decades after 9/11, we have now a whole new set of new security fears. And so we're getting ready for that. We're already seeing them talk about the terrorists now. That boogeyman is going to be brought right back to life, because Al-Qaeda is now congregating and they're accelerating all of their, you know, their evil, dark plans. And so we've already got a pivot towards domestic terrorism that we're going to talk about here in the last segment on this channel. But we've also got now the resurgence of international terrorism. And so we're going to be seeing a lot of that, of course. We got to, you know, make sure that we make all of our liberties that have already not been stripped from us due to the pandemic, make sure that those are ready and available to turn over to the government as soon as the new international terrorists become the boogeyman yet again. So we've seen a lot of this. U.S. citizens, they take in Kabul, they're told to take shelter. So no preparation. We got U.S. citizens just like, hey, good luck, figure it out, find shelter. Airport is just completely ransacked. We have analysis here from Susan Page, says America's chaotic exit is Biden's big defeat. And so a lot of that, right? A lot of the people who traditionally prior, you know, a week ago were, you know, Joe Biden's in charge. Finally, it's a return to norm. America's back in the game. And then we see this just botched. The whole thing is completely botched. This was a picture from the palace. You've probably seen most of these. We'll just make sure we plug these in here just for posterity, for future generations, and for this sake. We have the Taliban. They're in the palace. They're sitting, you know, this is the equivalent of the Oval Office, the Resolute Desk there, whatever they might call that there in Afghanistan, and they're behind it. The Taliban, okay, so you've got that going. We've seen that. We've seen most of the imagery. There's a lot of troubling things coming out. This was, I think, earlier this morning, and this is a troubling scene. It's going to cut short, so we're not going to see anybody die, but you'll note that once this airplane does take off into the air, that there are people that we're going to see who were attached to it that then later fall off and plunge presumably to their death. Has not been confirmed, of course, to me. I think it's all sort of been presumed in the media, but we're not going to watch any of that, right? We're going to keep this stuff. So all of the gruesome stuff is not going to come into play here, but this is a scene. You probably saw this. This was from the airport. This is a U.S. Air Force carrier that is filled with people, and we're going to show a picture of that later in on this segment, but you can see what's happening here. The entire runway is just filled with people who are, some of them are celebrating, I think. Some of them are cheering. Some of them are having fun. Some of them are scared to death and trying to get out of there. And so, you know, we're watching this stuff, and it's easy for people to sort of, well, you know, it's not my problem. It's not our fault. You know, well, I don't care anymore. Afghanistan is Afghanistan. And, you know, the United States has spent enough blood and money and time and resources over there that people just say, well, I don't care anymore, right? This is all over, and so what? It's Afghanistan. And I'm just not so quick to do that. You know, these are people who are trying to improve their lives. They're trying to live and not be killed. And so it's a sad thing what we're seeing here. But this is, you know, this is another government-caused disaster. You know, our government got involved in this, and they've been botching it for the last 20 years. This is the scene. All right, so sorry about that audio, quite loud, I know, but all right, so you saw just what happened there. Okay, they are literally hanging onto the side of the airplane, trying to escape as the Air Force is just pulling off. So not a good situation. That is the U.S. Air Force, right? This is like one of those scenes from a terrible sci-fi movie when, you know, all of the people are sort of abandoning the spaceship and people are clawing to get into the escape vessel before everything explodes. It's not a good scene. It looks like the U.S. government is incompetent. It looks like there was nothing that was planned. We have a situation here where there's a lot of harm to that airplane, right? To the pilots, to the U.S. citizens who are presumably on board. And we heard from the media today, or from the administration today, that no, we planned for all of these contingencies. I mean, we had it all figured out. We knew what we were doing. And so there was some expectation that this might maybe could possibly happen. And so we were prepared for that. That's why we had all of the troops standing by, ready to go back in. It's sort of like, you know, when you're walking down the street and you slip and you look like a moron and you get back up and you look around to see if anybody saw that. You're like, did anybody see that? And you just keep walking about your business. Well, we saw it. Yeah, we saw all of this, right? We saw the flub. It's not okay for them to come back out here and say, well, this, everything's fine, right? We planned for this. Obviously, we knew this could happen. And so this is just going according to plan. This doesn't look like it's going according to anybody's plan. Looks like the U.S. Air Force is barely getting out of a zombie movie where they're trying to, you know, escape the zombie horde. It is a catastrophe. It makes the U.S. look incompetent. And regardless of what you want to say about whether we should be in Afghanistan or not, it's embarrassing. It looks like a disaster because it is. Now, there are some, you know, in all of this tragedy, there are some moments of, I guess, more tragedy. Or if you want to sort of have fun with it, look at it with a little bit of levity. We have here somebody from CNN, big Joe Biden network, a lot of fans over there. We have Clarissa Ward. It's funny that her dress code changed in literally one day. So Representative Vicky Hartzler posted this on Twitter, said her dress code in Afghanistan compared to today, showcasing how crushing Joe Biden's incompetence will be for the future of Afghan women. And so, you know, I got to be honest, this woman is really impressive. The fact that she's over there right now and that she's still there, it's August 16th. And so all the prayers in the world to her. Hopefully she's doing well and her family's, you know, at some peace because she's in the middle of a war zone. But I mean, kudos to her. Got some serious cojones over there. And it says on August 15th, we see, right, she is not wearing a hijab. Then the next day, well, the city changed power. And now we have her in a nice hijab. So she puts on the outfit of the local environment, and that changed pretty quickly. Here is a closer up, you know, shot of this from CNN. This was a couple days ago, I think maybe yesterday. And then it all changes. This is a scene here where she's actually still sort of explaining this weird disconnect, saying, well, they're here and they're saying death to America, but they're actually pretty friendly.
They're just chanting death to America, but they seem friendly at the same time. It's utterly bizarre.
At the present.
So she's getting a lot of grief for that, for saying, you know, it's utterly bizarre, because it reminds everybody of the, what was the other one? Oh, the CNN, fiery but peaceful protest back during the BLM protest during the summer of unrest. Remember all of those, where that CNN reporter was like, well, yeah, I mean, all of these buildings are burning down to the ground, but it's pretty peaceful. You know, nobody's actually killing me. So all of this other mayhem and destruction, don't worry about that. It's mostly peaceful. So kind of the same concept here with this Clarissa over from CNN saying, no, I mean, they're shouting death to America, but otherwise, they're pretty friendly. And if you take a look at this screenshot, you can sort of see her disdain here. This image was, you know, not to poke fun too much at her, but she has that face sort of like, I can't believe I'm here. I can't believe this is happening right now, right? She has that face. When I make a dumb remark to my, you know, my girlfriend or anybody, this is kind of the face that I get from them. Like, are you serious right now? Are you enough, Rob? Come on, that's ridiculous. This guy over here is very happy about the situation. He's looking at Clarissa and he's saying to her, huh, well, that's about right. Yeah, yesterday you were here. You didn't have this hijab on, but now you're here. Now you have the hijab on. So he's very, very happy about it. He's sort of just looking at her just like, yeah, we're in charge now. It's hijab season, right? This guy seems like he might be enjoying it too. And so, you know, CNN is learning to play ball with the new administration, the same people who are ranting and raving about, you know, Donald Trump being a backward xenophobic monster who hates women and all of that stuff. Joe Biden comes in. This is the new situation in Afghanistan. So I hope they're enjoying that. That's who they voted for. All right. So enough of that. Let's take a look at what Joe Biden had to say. He gave a speech today. You may recall he was over at Camp David for a short couple days. Apparently he was on a vacation, was supposed to be there through Wednesday. The Taliban, you know, they're inconvenient. They didn't check his calendar. They didn't realize that he was out of the White House, out of office. And so they just went and did their insurrection, their seizure of a democracy. They just took it over. Joe Biden wasn't really bothered to really address that until today. And a lot of people on Twitter were saying, well, it's the weekend, you know, he's tired and he's probably working really hard. And so give him a little bit of slack. So then when the boiling point reached fever pitch, what happened was the White House said, oh, well, we better get a statement out here. This is looking pretty bad. So they picked Joe Biden up. They flew him over to the White House. He talked for 18 minutes, took no questions, not a single question, turned around and just made a beeline right for the door to get out of there faster than anybody wanted to get out of Kabul. They were just gone. And he didn't want to even talk to anybody. And so a lot of people are scratching their heads about this, saying, well, that's a little bit concerning, because then he hopped back onto an airplane and went right back to Camp David, right back to his vacation. So we got about 18 minutes out of the man, and then he deferred the rest of this over to his administration. This is one of the most experienced politicians in our entire country. Right? He's been in office longer than I've been alive. And so now he is supposed to be guiding us with his steady hand through this crisis. And we got 18 minutes, not a single question. That's it. So you can criticize the decision to leave Afghanistan, whether you want to be there anymore or not. That's one issue. You can have a conversation about whether the departure, whether you agree we should stay there or think that we should leave. You can also have some problems with the departure. You can say, well, that was botched. It should have been done a lot more cohesively with a lot more coordination. And then you can even have another layer of criticism here. You could say his response to the botching is also pretty bad. So we're going to take a look at this. I'm not going to dunk on him the entirety of the speech. There are some of this that I actually like. He sounds very much like Donald Trump, or like somebody who is also tired of foreign wars, which I am very much tired of, right? I haven't been ever somebody who has been understanding of what we're doing over there. I've lost sight of what America's interests are, fighting for the Middle East, fighting for that little pocket of land. For a long time now, and I think a lot of Americans agree with that. So Joe Biden comes out here, and now we can sort of measure him in terms of his leadership, right? The decision to leave Afghanistan, one decision on that. The decision about how to leave Afghanistan, another one. And then the response to the botch is another example where we can measure his leadership ability. And so we'll take a couple of these clips. I've got three clips. One's good, one's okay, and one's kind of bad. Let's start with the bad one first. This is where he's trying to blame Donald Trump, and this is logically inconsistent. This is why this is bad. And I don't care the fact that he blames Donald Trump, but it's just logically inconsistent. It doesn't make any sense, because what you're going to hear him say is sort of blame the predecessor, blame Donald Trump. We've heard this a lot, that Donald Trump already put this plan in place. So he had an agreement with the Taliban. Donald Trump is saying now, well, but we had conditions before we were going to withdraw. We were going to make them meet certain markers, and we would have never left in the way that you left. And Joe Biden and his administration have been trying to say, well, our hands were tied. We were put into a box here by Donald Trump. He entered into this agreement. We had to honor this thing. And if we didn't honor it, it would have required us to go back to war and all of that stuff. So he goes through this little, banter about blaming the prior administration before pivoting and saying, but it's the right thing to do. And he gives us a bunch of reasons as to why that is. So it's either he's upset that Donald Trump sort of forced his hand, or he's in agreement that Donald Trump was right and this needed to happen, and he's making it happen. So then I don't understand what the criticism is. So he's trying to have it both ways. To me, it felt like the speechwriter, somebody just had to put a little section in there to dunk on Donald Trump and to try to defray the blame some a little bit. But we're going to see here why that is just not appropriate. Let's take a look here. This is what Joe Biden had to say this afternoon for 18 minutes.
When I came into office, I inherited a deal that President Trump negotiated with the Taliban.
Okay.
Under his agreement, U.S. forces would be out of Afghanistan by May 1, 2021, just a little over 3 months after I took office.
Yeah.
U.S. forces had already drawn down during the Trump administration from roughly 15,500 American forces to 2,500 troops in country. And the Taliban was at its strongest militarily since 2001. The choice I had to make,
yeah,
as your president, was either to follow through on that agreement or be prepared to go back to fighting the Taliban in the middle of the spring fighting season.
Okay, so you see what he's doing there, right? He's framing it to say, well, look, I really was left with no options. I had no choice but to honor the prior administration's prior agreement. And there's, you can get into the complexities here, right? You can say, well, this agreement had conditions and that agreement had this and blah, 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 and the fighting season and spring and all of this crap. It's all crap, right? All of those excuses are garbage, right? We've been in Afghanistan for 20 years, right? Another year to secure a more competent withdrawal is like not that big of a deal in what, you know, my humble opinion. It is a big deal, but when you're talking about these types of conversations between the administration and military officials to avoid this botching, I think that they would have agreed maybe another year, another 6 months or whatever it is, would have been appropriate. In other words, to use that as an excuse, I think is just an absolute joke. We know that the administration has rolled back many other Trump policies. Here's a quick look of a couple of them. If you go onto Google and just search Biden reverses Trump, put that in parentheses and quotes there, you'll see Biden revokes a Trump era executive action on immigration, right? Huge issue. We have another one, executive order banning diversity, right? Biden reverses Trump, another one there. Biden reverses Trump policies on healthcare, abortion, COVID. That was in January. Biden reverses Trump efforts on TikTok. Okay, that was in June. Biden reverses Trump order barring immigrants. Okay, that was in May. Another one. Biden reverses Trump limiting U.S. nursing home, blah, 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 whatever. Another one. Biden reverses Trump changes bank to bank the list goes on and on. He got into office and reversed everything. Everything. So for him to come out here and say, well, my hands were tied, it is total nonsense. They could have easily, you know, manipulated the agreements and secured a more favorable withdrawal. Whether you think that that was appropriate or worth it or not is a whole separate conversation. But this was sort of a throwaway clip from Biden to just dump it back on Donald Trump. Okay, so that's fine. I think that's part of the, you know, probably one of the less effective parts of the speech. It seems to me like he is trying to pass the buck to somebody else. At the same time, when if you listen to the full speech, he talks a lot about the buck stops with me, right? It all stops with me. It's my decision. I double down on it. I stand by it. I confirm that it was the right thing to do, but my hands were tied. And it's also sort of a problem for me because the last guy put me in this position. Well, if it's the right thing to do, well, then why is that a problem? And you certainly did make some adjustments. You didn't follow his plan to a T, did you? You adjusted the whole thing. And so you are, as the president, responsible for that. And so to try to blame the last administration, I think was just ineffective, of course, though. But it is part of a Biden speech. You got to put in something to dig against the prior administration, including Donald Trump. All right. And so that was that segment. Let's take a look at this one. Now, this is where Joe Biden is doubling down on it, saying, I stand firmly behind my decision, and gives us a little bit of a breakdown as to what happened. Here he is.
I stand squarely behind my decision. After 20 years, I've learned the hard way that there was never a good time to withdraw U.S. forces. That's why we're still there. We were clear-eyed about the risks. We planned for every contingency, but
there it is.
I always promised the American people that I would be straight with you. The truth is, this did unfold more quickly than we had anticipated.
Okay. Okay, so you planned for every contingency, but it also happened a lot more quickly than you anticipated. So did you not actually prepare for that contingency then or not? Because if you did, it sounds like you kind of botched that, didn't you? Because you sent another 5,000, 6,000 troops back in there. If you had it orchestrated properly, I would guess that you don't have to go back and send more troops in there. So he goes out there and he's doing all he can do, right? There's, what else are you supposed to say here? Other than, yeah, didn't go exactly as we thought, but still the right move. And so they're trying to paper over this thing. Now, where I think this is another area where criticism is appropriate is, again, regardless of what you think about the decision, regardless of whether we should be in Afghanistan or not, that's important, of course. But the bigger point is more about the environment surrounding these decisions, okay? Joe Biden, Anthony Blinken, these were two elected officials of the United States government in the highest positions, the president and the secretary of state. They both told us, the entire country, in many of their press briefings and interviews that they gave before any of this stuff happened, that this was not a possibility, that it would not be a situation. Anthony Blinken said specifically it would not be like a Friday to a Sunday thing. It exactly was. Joe Biden said it wouldn't look like Saigon. It did, exactly did. it is still a debacle. We still have U.S. citizens and people who are still trying to board planes, and the administration has been basically asleep at the wheel over the last several days. So the question here, if you're going to be analyzing what happened, is where was this breakdown? Where was the disconnect between the administration and what was happening in reality? Because they told us something. So my question is, was the military and the intelligence community giving them bad information that they were not digesting, or that they were digesting and then regurgitating to the American people? Everything's fine. A withdrawal is going to work fine. The Taliban is not going to seize Kabul. The Afghan army is competent. Joe says, okay, thank you for the report, generals, and I'm going to go deliver that message to the American people. If that's the case, how can you be mad at Joe Biden over that? You can't. If it's the generals who are lying to him, who are lying to Donald Trump, who are lying to George Bush, or whatever's going on with the military or the intelligence community, that's not on Joe Biden. He's got to trust his generals and his intelligence community. And so that's a very important point. We have to decipher that. What is going on there? Where is the breakdown? Is it from the ground to the military? Is it between the interface between the military and the Afghan the people? Is it between the military and the U.S. government? Are they all in it together and they're all just lying to the American people? What's going on here? Who should be held accountable for this? Because we have thousands of dead Americans. We have billions of dollars that have been just absconded and thrown in somebody's bank accounts somewhere all over the world. And the entire Middle East is now in catastrophe mode. So it would be good to know specifically where that breakdown is, other than just saying, well, gosh, shucks, you know, any administration that was going to withdraw from this, it was going to be bad. Just happened to be me. I just sort of got the bad barrel in the Russian roulette. Sorry, I got the bad chamber there. That's not an appropriate example or postmortem here. We got to figure out what happened. Is that going to happen? Are we going to see military generals or anybody in this debacle resign or held accountable for it? No, of course not, because why? We never do anyways. All right, we got one more clip here from Joe Biden. And Joe Biden is here now making a great point, making a very keen observation, something that I've observed with the Afghan leaders and some of the people there, apparently, who were of the 300,000 people that Joe Biden was communicating to us were going to be there protecting the country. Here is Joe Biden now laying some truth down about the Afghans.
So what's happened? Afghanistan political leaders gave up and fled the country. The Afghan military collapsed, sometime without trying to fight. If anything, the developments of the past week reinforced that ending U.S. military involvement in Afghanistan now was the right decision. American troops cannot and should not be fighting in a war and dying in a war that Afghan forces are not willing to fight for themselves.
It's hard to argue with that, folks. You know, it's hard to argue with that. When we were talking about this last week, we were covering it, we were reading different stories of the Taliban almost being greeted as liberators, right? Because they could use their motorcycles again. They could use their little mopeds or motorbikes, because under the old Afghan government, they were not allowed to do that because those were vehicles that the Taliban used. Taliban comes in, a lot more freedom, a lot more liberty. They're not locked down anymore. And so they were almost greeted as liberators. We've got some clips here I'm going to show you about, you know, they're kind of having a good time there in Taliban Afghanistan. So that was the last clip from Joe Biden saying Afghan leaders gave up. They did. The president was gone. I think they still don't know where he is. And so if your inner core, if the core of your country, the people who are supposed to be symbolically representing you, who are supposed to be the strongest stakes in the ground to make sure that the country does not get derailed, they just bailed, abandoned, shipped, right? It'd be like the founding fathers in this country. You'd have Madison, Jefferson, Washington, all of them. Oh, the British just landed? Washington and Jefferson, they all just go, oh, well, it's been a good run, everybody, but we're off to Canada. So long. See how long the rest of the country is able to hold it together. And so, you know, that begs the next question. Joe Biden and all of the other presidents, all of these other military people, all of the bureaucrats that installed these leaders, these officials over there in the Afghani government and spent the last 20 years telling us how great they are. Oh, these are really good people. We trust them. You know, they're primed to be able to bring their country, turn things around and create a new democracy in the Middle East. They are our partners over there. What kind of character judgment do these bureaucrats have? Or do they know something that we don't know? Are they being honest with us? Or is this all just a rotten scheme and they're just out there paying lip service, talking up their useful ally in whatever grift they're being a part of? Because now it sure looks like that all of their judgments about these presidents and about these elected officials are all a little bit off, right? Don't recommend me, Joe, or Nancy Pelosi, or any U.S. officials currently who've been elected in the last 20 years. Don't recommend to us, the American people, the next leader of a free country, because you have a terrible recommendations. They're terrible. Your restaurants are bad. All of your movie recommendations are terrible. Your dictator representations are also all just awful. They're supposed to be very strong leaders there in Afghanistan, and they just got on the first plane out of there. So no thanks. We don't need any more of those. Now, Joe Biden was very, very quick to get out of the White House. Now, he gave his 18-minute speech. And again, we're sort of measuring the leadership response as a leader of a country, as the leader of America, the country that led the coalition against terrorism back after 2001, that put boots on the ground all over the Middle East for the last 20 years, that has a number of different allies in different parts of the world that we've been working with that still rely on the United States. You would imagine that at a moment like this, your president, the leader of the free world, would come out, spend a little bit more than 18 minutes talking about these issues, acknowledge a little bit more about what actually took place, why this was so problematic, and then give a clear opportunity to clarify some of the outstanding questions, right? The press has a lot of questions. We haven't heard from Joe Biden or this administration in the last 3 days. Now he's out there, finishes his 18-minute speech, and presumably he's available for questions, right? He's going to stand there and take some questions from the press. But Joe Biden doesn't do that. No, here he is. On his way out, he hightails it for the door as soon as the speech is over. Here it is.
Diplomats and all brave Americans serving in harm's way.
I'm out. Pew! Gone. Gone with the wind. Just turns around, walks right out the door. Press is screaming like a bunch of hyenas. Hey, Joe, you kind of botched this whole thing. Your foreign policy is crumbling literally in real time. The American people have lost faith in the competence that your administration claimed to have. So maybe a couple questions? No. Slams the book. Teleprompter's over. Nothing else to read anymore. Certainly can't wrap his head around what's going on. So he just makes a beeline right for the door. And he's out of there. Bye-bye, Joe. Faster than they left Kabul, he's gone. So now we know he's going back to the Camp David vacation. Here he is. This is from the press briefing room, whatever, you know, wherever this document comes from. The president delivered remarks by 1 p.m. The president departs Washington, D.C., going back to Camp David. And a lot of people on Twitter are also noticing that Jen Psaki is out as well. She's on vacation until August 22nd. Very convenient. People were sending her emails and they were getting the autoresponder. Oh, no. We're on vacation. Sorry, Jen Psaki's not available. Meanwhile, the U.S. military is doing what it can to save lives and bring them out of the country. Here is what Ian Bremmer posted over on Twitter. Says this is inside a U.S. transport that's taking off from Kabul, calling it extraordinary, right? This is what it looks like. And so for all of the people out there who just want to say, well, whatever, screw Afghanistan. We've been there for 20 years, whatever, forget about it. Let's take a look, right? I mean, there are In this photograph, there are women and children, right? There's a young man right here, another young person here, a child over here. This child over here is drinking from a bottle. Kids, women, kids, just packed into this thing. It's a horrendous scene. It's a humanitarian crisis. This is on a U.S. convoy. This is something that the U.S. should have been prepared for. They're telling us that they were prepared. Oh, we had all the contingencies planned. We had it all figured out. Certainly doesn't look like it, right? They're going to be just sloshing around in an aircraft as they fly around to whatever their next destination is. And so then, you know, the next, of course, question is, well, where do these people go? Or do we just bring them into the United States now? And now the United States is responsible for all of them in addition to that? And you might say, well, no, send the plane back, turn that around. But at the same time, the U.S. caused all of this, right? The U.S. created an environment where these people were relying on U.S. security. The U.S. just bailed. And so now, you know, what do we do? It's a tough situation. That's why I'm looking forward to hearing your answers and your questions on this, because it's a complicated issue. All right, so moving on, what does the rest of the world have to say about this? We're going to get into questions soon, I promise. The Times of India is reporting that the Pakistani Prime Minister Imran Khan says that the Afghans have broken the shackles of slavery. says that they seized power, and President Ghani fled the war-torn country. So the prime minister said that, yeah, I mean, they were in slavery, and now they've broken those chains. So the Pakistan government sounds like it is now aligning with the Taliban. The Chinese are having fun with this. The Chinese are saying, from what happened in Afghanistan, those in Taiwan should perceive that once a war breaks out in the Straits, the island's defense will come in hours, and the U.S. military won't come to help. As a result, the DPP will quickly surrender. So they are just poking, you know, not fun. They are needling the United States, saying that, hey, Taiwan, you know your allies over there, the U.S., the people that said that they were going to protect you against the reunification between China and Taiwan, the same reunification that President Xi has talked about, saying that we're going to reunify in the next 10 years. We are coming for you, Taiwan. They've made that pretty clear. And so now the U.S., because of their inability to see things through, looks like an unreliable ally. Taiwan, maybe unlike Afghanistan, is a very key strategic interest to the United States, largely for their technological capacity, for the chips that they make there. So China knows that. And China is very quick to make sure that they wag their fingers in the entire face of the United States, any opportunity they get. You remember when Anthony Blinken went over there and said, hey, what are you doing about the Uyghurs? They said, well, what are you doing about the BLMers there? And Anthony's like, oh, yeah, you're right. I guess we're idiots. And then also, now they're saying, Taiwan, the U.S., they don't have your back anymore. Look what they just did to Afghanistan. So that's not too good. All right, well, let's take a look over at some questions here from watchingthewatchers.locals.com and see what is going on over here. All right, we're going to pull up the questions. I think I saw a super chat come in there from Paul Bryant. Thanks, Paul. Saw that. No question on there, but I appreciate the support. All right, let's see what is here from watchingthewatchers.locals.com. We've got I'm Not Gas says, don't worry. The UN wants to import at least 1 million Afghan refugees. I'm sure the cowards who couldn't even stand up to defend their homes for more than one day will be great additions to our country. Yeah, it's a great point, right? If they have civic values and virtues that are entirely different than the country, it makes it difficult to assimilate. Are we learning our lessons on that? If people don't want democracy, if America can't go over there and install democracy, is it a good idea then to bring people who don't want to participate in democracy, who don't understand enlightenment ideals like the Bill of Rights and things like that, into the country and to try to acclimate them? Seems like you're trying to do the same thing in reverse. We have DeadMau5 says, everyone knew this ending was inevitable, but Jesus, oof, effing, yeah. Out of all the possible transitions out of Afghanistan, this has to be one of the worst. Was this also Biden could try and time a photo op for the 20th anniversary of September 11th? Yeah, link to Switch getting unplugged in the Matrix. Yeah, let's see if we can grab this one real quick. What is this here? Not like this. Not like this. And it didn't have it, but she drops dead right there. Yeah, not good. Yeah, welcome, DeadMau5. I know you just signed up. Welcome to the community. Great, great question. Sharon Quidney says, Afghan was a nightmare for the Russians before it became the U.S.'s nightmare. For all those who hate the U.S., including those in this regime, that's most of them, it's a great triumph, a day for rejoicing. Oh, I hope that's not true, Sharon. Seems like it's pretty terrible all around. We got Donald Trump is here, says, the Dolma Agreement was a wonderful deal for peace in Afghanistan. It was an orderly withdrawal of the troops. But Demented Joe is even bigger than mine, his ego. He needed to withdraw by May 1st and then delayed it to 9/11. The order of withdrawal to shred the documents, the order to evacuate equipment, evacuate everything was problematic. Sleepy Joe should retire. Yeah, Donald Trump said so. Yeah, Donald Trump said that, I think officially even. Sergeant Bob is here, says, Biden spent 40-some years in politics and never was a leader. Now with his mental capacity, it's only worse. Very predictable. As the Brits would say, this is a right good cock-up. All right, maybe he could just assign this to Kamala. Well, yeah, I mean, look, Joe is well, first of all, Kamala is very, very good at not succeeding. So she'd be great for this because it's already not a success. And so put her in charge of this and she'll continue to make sure that it is not a success. She's got a very good track record with the border. He put her in charge to go solve that thing. Not going to happen. Obviously, it's actually getting dramatically worse. And so, I think Afghan is already basically beyond repair. So yeah, we could put Kamala in charge of that because it won't get any better. We also have LT13 says, did you see the pic of Biden at Camp David? Yeah, dox some people. He was wrong for what time would be in Moscow. The only times that would have matched up were in March. Yeah, so let me explain this. LT13 is saying there's this image. Joe Biden, it was a wild image. The White House posted this. I didn't clip it, but the White House posted this over on their Twitter, official Twitter account. Joe Biden is over there at Camp David. They have a screen up in front of him, and they've got all of these different people on there. Kamala Harris is on there. She's in the Naval Observatory, and there are no books behind her. So people are saying, well, that's weird. Is that a real set? You know, she's been in that Naval Observatory there for a couple of months now. You'd imagine she'd put some books back there. What's going on with that? Is this a fake image? And Joe Biden is sitting there. He's got a notepad open and there's nothing written on it. So he's got this pen and he's just like going to write in this like blank notepad, talking to some people on the screen, even though the microphone on notifications are not on. What LT13 is talking, so meaning maybe he can't speak to them. And so what LT13 is talking about is the clocks up there on the image are not necessarily right. So Moscow, the difference between Moscow and London, it should have been like a 3-hour difference or whatever it is. And it's only a 2-hour difference because that was pre-daylight savings time. And now it's, you know, whatever. And so somebody did the math and the clocks don't match up. And so now people are saying, is that even a real picture? It's probably, folks, just that the clocks are wrong because our government is that incompetent. Yeah, why would the clocks be right? Nothing else is right, so there's nobody to change the clocks. So that's probably all it is. But I love those conspiracy theories. Love it. It's a lot of fun. And Joe Biden is basically absent, so I think it fits. And he's writing in a blank notebook. What is he going to be writing there? Oh, okay. I have to check on this for that general. What are you talking about? Okay, anyways. Ken on Locals says, cannot imagine anything more incoherent or incompetent than the Afghanistan withdrawal debacle. How many hours before the media starts to ignore Americans caught behind enemy lines who will no doubt be tortured, murdered, or both in favor of blaming the only policy of Trump's Biden didn't reverse immediately? I know. It's a good question. I think that you're probably going to see a lot of sweeping away of the follow-up here. Media is just going to move on with this. That was the signal from the speech today. Joe Biden came out. No, I'm doubling down. Don't ask me about it again. Don't talk about it again. Move on. That was the signal. Not taking questions. This is a hard line in the sand. Get in line. And they probably will. The Taliban is here. Says, thanks, Joe, for the heavy equipment, planes, and giving Afghanistan on a silver platter. The Taliban's here. Hopefully they're supporting the show. Sharon Quinney says, anything coming out of the mouths of this regime you can count on as being as lies start to finish. It's all about Kabuki. Now the Taliban is back. ISIS will be back. And my guess is they're going to be talking about domestic right-wing extremists and white supremacists. Yeah, they're actually called now, I think, racial and ethnic violent extremists, Sharon. We're going to talk about that in the third segment today. We've got Choppas in the house. Says, there's been some talk that the Taliban made deals with political and military leaders in Afghanistan and that they were either bribed or convinced to desert. There were either massive intelligence failures on the part of the U.S., which would be bad, or they knew about it, did nothing, which would be worse. Yeah, I am hopeful that there's a lot more digging that goes on as a result of this, but I'm not optimistic about that because you need the media to do the digging. You need politicians to do the digging, and the Republicans are also asleep at the wheel, right? They don't care. Lavoisier is here, says, I'd like to formally congratulate the militias in Afghanistan for winning a war against a country with F-16s and nuclear weapons using only AK-47s and IEDs. Yeah, it's actually pretty amazing. And we spent billions of dollars, lost thousands of lives, and it's just kind of back to the way it was 21 years ago, isn't it? NY Renal MD says, the only difference between Kabul and Saigon is that we haven't heard from Henry Kissinger yet. He is still alive, so we may hear from him to whitewash this foreign policy debacle. Yeah, Kissinger still, he's still alive. Want to Know says, Rob, do you think it would be a good idea to send Kamala, AOC, Omar, and others over to Afghanistan to make sure that the BLM and the rainbow flags are going to fly over the new Afghan capital? Yeah, probably. Probably also to make sure that they've got their dossier of pronouns in place. Says it would help to prove it's new Taliban. Stay till the mission is completed. Help to prove there's not prejudice there. Stay at the U.S. Embassy till the mission is completed and hand out little pink hats with Madonna. Yeah, that's great. Want to Know. Exactly right. Yeah, the pronouns. You know, look, if Governor Kardashian. What's her name? Jenner. If Governor Jenner can't win in California, maybe she can win with the Taliban over there. Yeah, that might be good. We have a tight tinfoil hat says, look at the squirrel. While we segregate the POC anti-vaxxers from their food, causing food riots in NYC and San Francisco. Oh no, shootings. Joe declares gun a public health emergency. Joe ignores the Second Amendment rights. All guns must be accounted for and turned into public health authorities. Tyranny in the back door. That was from tight tinfoil hat. A lot more questions here. Sharon says, you say it looks like this government is incompetent. If it looks like a duck, etc., how much more proof would anybody need? It's a good point there. Three Girlies is here, says, as a Navy brat, ex-Air Force wife, this Afghanistan withdrawal is an unbelievable failure of the political class. Has completely ripped apart my friends and family. Wow. I've had a very emotional weekend. Saigon on steroids does not cover this hell. I do not believe we should be there, but this was done wrong. What is worse, the Afghan people did not deserve this, right? Seeing them claw for any chance for freedom and saving has just added to it all. Biden did not have a plan at all. He needs to be removed, and a whole lot of top leaders in our government need to be fired. Add to this the long impeachment list for Biden. Yeah, I agree with you on that, Three Girlies. I think that, you know, if we had a real country that really had, you know, honor and integrity and people were held accountable, you would see resignations already, right? You'd see these generals who we hear about being the most honorable, sacrificial people on the planet, that, you know, they just are nothing but selfless, botching this and feeding, shoveling BS down all of our throats for the last two decades. You'd think that they would have a little bit of shame, but they don't. They all just sort of, you know, deflect the blame. Joe Biden comes out, well, it is what it is. Media is going to say, well, it is what it is. And a lot of people have lost limbs, lives, you know, brothers and sisters. And it is a horrific thing to think about that, you know, all of this was sort of done without much purpose, without much oversight. It was way worse than we expected. And there are a lot of people that got rich off this, and there are a lot of families that lost loved ones. And if we had a justice system, you would say, well, maybe we should go find that money. Maybe we should go get every single dollar of that back that was stolen from this country and pay it to the families who lost loved ones as a result of this government catastrophe. Is that ever going to happen? I hope so. We have next up, we have here a Leafy Bug says, when I was young and stupid, I thought the regime change wars were effective. The only way to prevent another 9/11. Yeah, I bought into that too, Leafy Bug. I was younger. 9/11 happened when I was 16, I think. And so I agreed to make the world a better place. Then people jumped to their deaths from the tower to escape inferno caused by religious fanatics flying planes into buildings. Today, people are jumping to their deaths from U.S. planes to get the hell out of Dodge to escape religious fanatics. Is the world a better place? I'm not so sure, Leafy Bug. I don't think so. I think the world is going the wrong direction for the time being. We have Aircraft Mech says, rumor has it that the footage of the C-17 being taken over was actually a Trump rally. They're coming to thank Trump, I guess. We have over here, No Question says, looks like a good time to drop a couple radioactive freedom seeds. That's not appropriate. There was no name on that. I suspect I know why. Refanilator is here, says, this is pretty bad, but the administration concerned at all about the women and children in Afghanistan. First stream live since joining locals. That's from Refanilator. Refanilator, tell me if I'm getting your name right or wrong, and I'll do my best to correct that. And welcome to the community. I just saw you signed up. Your name is on the board there. Thank you for that. I'm grateful that you're here. Joe Biden said that they're concerned about women and children, but I don't know, because the actions don't match the rhetoric, do they? Kenny1B says, as someone who does some contingency planning for certain parts of the government, there really isn't all that much planning. Capabilities are generally way overblown. Hunters here says, Dad screwed up. He's not as incompetent as me, but it's okay. He'll fix it. By the way, Robert, do you know where my laptop is? I think that prostitute that we talked about last week, I think she has it. Red-pilled convict says, ladies, get one of those at the CNN merch store. Yeah, I get the CNN hijabs now, the CNN Taliban hijab. Oh, my goodness. Let's see here. Thunder 7 says, I miss the orange Cheeto. The Taliban were afraid of him and Pompeo. Orange Cheeto told them that if they break the Doha withdrawal protocols, he's going to send vengeance. Biden changed the date. U.S. snuck out, left military hardware behind. Taliban, they got new Humvees, trucks, shiny new drones. Yet another colossal failure by China Joe. There's a good comment there, Thunder. We have Coucher says, what is it going to take to have someone resign? And for God's sake, who is running the country. I don't know who is. Three Girlies is here, says, Clarissa Ward changed her dress because she was interviewing the Taliban leadership. She went to Bagram Air Base, saw them taking over all the ammunition. They were happy to answer her questions so it would get out to the world. She changed so they wouldn't kill her. Yeah, I understand that, Three Girlies, and I maybe shouldn't have poked fun about that, right? She's doing what she needs to do. She is there with CNN. I think she's brave as hell for being there, right? She's on, like, death's doorstep with one wrong move, I would suspect. But maybe she also has a little bit of armor there because she is a journalist. She is with CNN, and the Taliban knows that they can use her for their propaganda, right? They want to show this victory, this seizure of Kabul, and they're going to make sure that that is being broadcast everywhere. And of course, the media is happy to oblige with that. Why shouldn't they? They're the new government there. That's who's in charge. So the media has to report on them. We have over here from I'm Not Gas says Biden's first real crisis not being handled very well. I agree with the decision to pull out, but looking at this, it's crazy. They had absolutely no plan. Did they expect the Taliban to just sit nicely and wait for everyone to leave? I don't know. I'm not sure really what they were expecting. Speeches here says, funny how Russia, China, even the Middle East don't dare do anything when Trump was president because they knew Trump would act. Just the threat of Trump was enough. However, the whole world knows Biden is weak, won't do anything. So that's why they're all acting up now. I think there's a lot of truth to that. That was from speech. We have the Taliban also here says, demented Joe, you're so incompetent. Now we're going to have sex slaves. And we're going to execute people and implement Sharia law. Josh Halgering is here, says the Afghan people had 20 years to decide if they really wanted to reject the Taliban. That's an entire generation of people. When the Taliban came, they dropped their rifles immediately. No more American boys need to die there. Drones and cruise missiles can do the work from here on out. Yeah, I agree with that, John. I agree, right? Look, if the people themselves are not willing to stand up and defend themselves or take this opportunity, I agree. I think that enough already. And that's where we're at. We have B. Thorne says, the incompetence of Sloppy Joe's administration is on full display. His address was pitiful. It's just sad having an absent leader. But I'm wondering, besides the newly discovered DHS threat, what is this misdirecting our attention from? I just finally joined up on Locals. I try to watch the show every day. Keep up the good work. That is from B. Thorne. Welcome, B. Thorne. Thankful that you are here. You know, it's a good question. And I was asking myself the same thing. My first instinct is, well, if we don't have the military industrial complex over there in the Middle East, do you think that those contractors are just going to go away and that this whole institution just disappears? No, of course not. It just comes right back over here. It just comes back on home. They've already been transitioning this anyways. Joe Biden said, you know, one of the biggest threats, I think it's, you know, being debated amongst climate change, but we also have white supremacy, domestic violent extremism, we have homegrown extremists, and the list goes on and on. We're going to talk about all of that, but if the country is buckling down here at home, if people are trying to flee the country or move states, and we have a lot more resources to move from the international terrorist to the new domestic terrorist, well, you can just see where this is going. And I don't doubt that for a second, unfortunately. Mustafa is here, says, thank you, America, for my brand new Humvee. My cousin Mustafa got a new fortune. Oh, we've got the Taliban. The Taliban is infiltrating the show. Donald Trump says, Joe Biden, don't blame the train wreck on me. You broke the government yourself. Next, we have Sharon says, oh, please, I can hear the cheering and yelling. And yeah, man, of the mic, cheering and blaming Trump for anything and everything. That's from Sharon. Nadarb is here, says, the photos of the Taliban in the offices look eerily similar to some of the photos that journalists just happened to take there during the take to the Capitol chaos. How did the Taliban get into Nancy's office? Not so much difference in the levels of security with this and that day. Many similarities. Yeah, it is. It is kind of similar. It's like they were able to take over the entire city in a couple days. They were able to take over the Capitol building here in a couple of hours. And so, yeah, maybe the security states, maybe Afghanistan was a little bit more secure than the Capitol building on that day. What a joke. John Halgren says, when someone says the truth is, the next thing they say is very likely not the truth. Did I say that? We have Ghost Gunner says, Rob, why would the military care about this withdrawal? Last I checked, this isn't purging Republicans from the armed services or brainwashing people with critical race theory and LGBT propaganda. Yeah, that's true. I think that, yeah, you know, I think, didn't General Miley, one of them said something about, wanting to understand white rage, something like that. I think a lot of the country is pretty enraged over how this happened. Don't know if it's only white people who are upset about how the country handled this, but maybe they are seeing more of it. Maybe that's what they're going to refocus their efforts on. Anybody who's mad about how badly the military botched Afghanistan might be exhibiting some white rage, might be a libertarian, might be anti-government, might need to be monitored and surveilled by the Department of Homeland Security. Hmm. Yeah, it's a good point there. That's from Ghost Gunner. Next up, we've got Lauren S. says, hey, Rob, I have to give it to Biden on this one. Americans shouldn't be fighting and dying in a war for another country that won't fight for itself. That's from Lauren S. I don't disagree with that, candidly, right? I think that Biden is right on that mark. We have Kenny 1B says, Biden ignored his intelligence briefings on the Taliban. Decision is based on ideology and ignores reality. I'm still waiting for some confirmation on that. We have the last villain that says, me and my ex-soldier contractor sat in my sister's living room 2 months ago and divined this scenario. Why couldn't the top brass? People are trying to give him a pass for this epic fumble. We needed to leave, but that scene at the airport was eerie as hell, full apocalypse. Do you think that he should have put Kamala out in front of this? in front of what, the airplane? Yeah, I mean, she could have settled that down. She went down to Guatemala and wagged her finger in all the Guatemalans' faces and said, don't come. So she should have just been out there in Afghanistan and said, hey, Taliban, don't you come into our airport. Because I think that's her only solution. I don't know what else she can do. She hasn't done anything else except talk, and poorly at that. Next up, we've got John Halgren says, the Taliban obviously bought millions of doses of vaccine. COVID disappeared in Afghanistan without the CDC intervention. Yeah, that's the other question, is why didn't the CDC just... The CDC should have just extended the eviction moratorium over the embassy and sent the Taliban a memo that the Supreme Court said that, or the Office of Legal Counsel said that that's no problem, and the Supreme Court hasn't ruled on it yet. So, yeah, they can just see. Sorry, Taliban. Rachel Walensky over from the CDC said, you can't kick us out because of COVID. And by the way, put your masks on because this is offensive. We have over here, TOS Forever says, after seeing the women and children in the airplanes, it makes more sense. We take women and children out first. Those were fathers running beside the plane knowing their family is safe. So might be Biden is short because they are bringing people in who support the Constitution. Well, you have a lot of faith, TOS Forever. I like your optimism on that. I got some doubts about it, but we'll see. Yum Yum says, Taco Bell. Okay, I can't read that. Okay, we have Leafy Bug says, the U.S. military is the most effective fighting force in the world at tactical and operational levels, almost always betrayed at the strategic level. It effortlessly wins the wars it is tasked to fight, yet slowly loses the periods of peace it is tasked to enforce. Once more, we see the folly of these prolonged engagement. It is bad enough that the military is repeatedly dishonored by the people in D.C. responsible for these disasters and debacles, many of whom still make bank from their policymaking. For every soldier that returns from these misadventures in a casket, several more come home and take their own lives as a result of what they went through. The loss of these lives are a price the people who sent them into harm's way are willing to pay. Yeah, they are. Yeah, because they have no skin in the game. There are no consequences for them. It's not their son. It's not their money. And everybody else has to foot the bill for their incompetence. It's offensive. Baloha says the 25th Amendment was trending at number 13 today. I have to say this, though. I believe this is elder abuse with Dr. Jill at the forefront. I don't like to defend him, but Joe has been abused since the announcement that he was running for president. Yeah, he is not there, right? I think he's been gone for a long time. And I don't like to say that, right? It sort of feels mean to say that, but you can see it in his eyes. Even today when he was speaking, he loses the teleprompter sometimes, and you can see it in his eye movements. You can see when he sort of loses it, and then he gets it again. And then you can see his eyes, the little micro expressions. He's a couple brain cells away from not being able to do that, in my opinion. I'm not a medical doctor. Now, Sweet Potato says, even though the Biden admin is ruining America, you have to take a step back and appreciate the blessings of living here. I can't imagine the fear of the women being treated as lesser and the real fear of being trafficked in the situation. Prayers for them. All those images and video of the tarmac are heartbreaking. Yeah, I completely agree with that, Sweet Potato. It is a sad thing, right? We have to sort of remember this. Even though it is a catastrophe, even though America cannot be the basket for the entire world, that to serve the entire world, it is a sad, it's a humanitarian catastrophe. It's a sad thing. I feel for the people over there. I feel for the people who have sacrificed to go and make that a better place. It's a bad day. It's not good. We have Donald Trump says the Afghanistan withdrawal highlighted how big human stupidity is. That is talking about Joe Biden. Over here we have Scott Morris. Screw Scott Morrison says here in Australia, Scott Morrison said that he. Okay, so he's going to enforce lockdowns. We have another question here from Josh Sesko says, with less assets tied up in Afghanistan, we'll be better equipped to support Taiwan. That's another good point. Little geopolitics there. Anki Wo is here. I think that's on the next segment. So we're going to get to that here next. Tinfoil hat fell off. Look over here. Okay. We've got a couple more questions. Then we're going to move on to the next segment because we spent a lot of time on this one here today. Aircraft Mech, last question here before we take a look at the Super Chats, says, once the Taliban is brought here, a few southern visitors won't bother anymore. Oh, that's a horrendous thought. Want to Know says, Rob, you need to be nicer to Kamala. She's the next president. True poll numbers are down because she's a woman. I know. I'm sorry. I'm a chauvinist. I know. Trump wants her as the president after Biden resigns. All right. Let's take a look at some super chats over from Just Cow says, Rob, did you see Biden's Afghan crisis fix? Eat some chocolate chip. Sorry, I'm behind on the segments. That's from Just Cow's. Yeah. I mean, he's back at Camp David. He's probably got a whole gallon of ice cream over there at Camp David. Thank you for the super chat, Just. We have DG McBride says, note to CNN, this is what an insurrection looks like. Okay, this is when you take over a country and you seize control of the government and now you run things. It's not when somebody takes a podium and walks it into the foyer of the Capitol building and then the government resumes their operations about 3 hours later. Little bit different. And DG McBride is helping to illustrate that for us. Super Iron Bob is here, says, the admin attempted to move the change over outside the fighting season, a ploy the other side would rightfully distrust. Yeah, okay, so, yeah, Super Iron Bob giving us a little bit of the military inside baseball going on. And so, great questions. Love all of those coming over from watchingthewatchers.locals.com, where people are chatting away. We got Pinkies here now. We've got I'm Not Gas. We've got Bumma Lickit all having conversations over there, along with John Dillard over at Locals. Over on YouTube, big thank yous to Super Iron Bob, Doug McBride. We had Just Cows and others who supported us with the Super Chats today. Really do appreciate all of that as well. Thanks so much for watching. Before you head out, I want to just remind you that I am a criminal defense lawyer here in Scottsdale, Arizona, where my team and I, we've got a long history of helping good people facing criminal charges to find safety, clarity, and hope in their cases and beyond that in their lives. Our phone number for a free case evaluation is 480-787-0394. You can also find us online at www.rrlawaz.com. We can help with any type of criminal charge in the state of Arizona, things like DUI, drug offenses, misdemeanor offenses. And we can also help with clearing up old case records, like expunging cases or making sure that you can restore your rights so that you can vote again or possess a firearm again or apply for some other federal benefits. We can remove mugshots off the internet. Basically, anytime that you or somebody you know or love is in trouble with the law in the state of Arizona, we have an amazing team of people. We would just love the opportunity to help. And our phone number, of course, 480-787-0394. And if you don't need any legal services, that's a very good thing. But you may be interested in some informational offerings so that you are prepared if you do have to deal with the police. And of course, I want to invite you to head on over to gumroad.com/Robert Grueler. You'll notice here, I've got several different trainings that are available, including the law enforcement interaction training. This is the 1-2-3 rule for dealing with the police. It's one rule you need, two questions that the police can ask of you, and three responses if they ask you a problematic question. So that's available now. You can also get a load up by personal productivity system here called Existence Systems. Fun little course. And then we have here, if you're a lawyer or a legal professional, be sure to check out this program. We are meeting twice every month. Again, all of this over at gumroad.com/Robert Grueler. And if none of that sounds any good to you, well, just go ahead and give us a follow because I'm working on some other products and some other offerings. And of course, if you have not already done so, want to invite you one more time to head on over to watchingthewatchers.locals.com. It's where you can support the show and it's where we can connect. We've got monthly Zoom meetings and a lot of other goodies coming up. So I look forward to seeing you there. Thank you so much for watching and for all of your love and support. I will see you on the next one.